Now on Radio 4, it's time to pull up to the bumper and hop on board for the next leg of this musical adventure.
Hello and welcome to Add to Playlist with me, Jeffrey Boachie.
And me, Jess Gillam.
A huge welcome to the show, Jess. Just to explain, in case you missed it, Keris has had surgery on a broken arm and has had to take a couple of weeks off. So we're thrilled to have you, Jess, standing in, or sitting, for Keris today. Brilliant to have you here.
Really happy to be here, and I hope Keris is okay, but looking forward to the show.
Fantastic. I can see that you're in the hot seat, but you've got something with you.
I have. I rarely travel without a saxophone, so I have got it with me today.
I know there's more than one. Which one is this?
Today I've got my soprano, so the straight one in the family, one of the smaller and higher ones in the family.
All right. It's sounding really good. To throw you in at the deepest end, could you explain to us how the show works, please, Jess?
I'll try, Jeffrey. So we start each show with a piece of music. We have a look at it, see what makes it work and what musical building blocks have been used. And then we challenge ourselves to find another tune that's somehow connected but sounds completely different. So it's a pretty good game.
All right, you've got the gig, OK? As ever, we're joined by music specialists in the studio to help us create the five-track playlist. And today, I'm delighted to welcome the composer and conductor, Leo Gaia, who's worked with, among others, the English Chamber Orchestra and Opera North. Leo, welcome to the studio.
Hello, thank you very much for having me.
Now, it's great to see that you've brought something with you as well.
I certainly have, and it sounds like this.
It's a bassoon. What's going on in Add to Playlist land? We had two bassoons last episode.
It Linton sounds to me like bassoon bias.
We're going very big on bassoon. Welcome, Leo.
And at the piano today, we welcome Add to Playlist regular Gillian Moore. She's Artistic Associate at London's South Bank Centre and recipient of a CBE for Services to Music. Hello, Gillian.
It's lovely to be back.
Beautiful piano.
Welcome both. As ever, we pick up where we left off at the end of the previous episode, which in this case was In the Mood by Glenn Miller. So, Jess, over to you to kick off our proceedings. Where does that 1939 classic take you for track one, and what's the link?
Well, I was listening to those arpeggios that make In the Mood the track it is, and it got me thinking about Bach, because he could use arpeggios and broken chords like a king. So if you listen to those swinging arpeggios in the Mood, straighten them out a little bit, speed them up ever so slightly, and we get to Prelude in C Major by Bach.
That we get so excited by so many different things that actually being bold, one idea, nailed it.
The opening of the Prelude from the Prelude and Fugue in C Major from the Well-Tempered Clavier by Johann Sebastian Bach, written in 1722, played here by Andras Schiff. Gillian.
I mean, this is a piece that lots of people, when they're learning the piano, play, because it's actually technically not that hard. And it starts in perhaps the simplest place that any music can start, which is a chord of C major. And you've got only one chord change per bar in this piece, but there's something so brilliantly sophisticated about the way Bach does this. So at the beginning you see the C major, and then you have a chord of D minor. It goes on to a chord of D minor, so instead of just going, it goes, it keeps the C in the bass, so you get tension immediately, a crunch, and then you resolves that again a bit. Then it's here we are again. Then you have it. And it moves through these chords with creating amazing tension and resolution. Listen to that scrunchiness there. Scrunchy, a bit of resolution. And then for the first time, we've got a proper change of key into G major. And then more, that's all bright and sunny, and then more tension, and then into D minor. So it just takes you through this harmonic movement in such an original way. And it's an absolute masterclass in how to make something very simple so sophisticated. And it's a joy to play as well. You know, it just lies under your fingers so beautifully and it flows.
And in so much of Bach's music, it's this kind of black and white, the tension and release that we hear. Maybe we could just look at the first four bars.
Yeah.
So we get that C major, so all the white notes of the piano as well. Maybe we could just hear the C major, just as a chord. And then when we hear that bar two, when it goes up, so we still got the C and the bass, and then with the D, and then the resolve, and then taking us back home.
Yeah.
So even in the first four bars, Bach has kind of set up what he intends to do across all of these preludes and fugues, the major to the minor.
Exactly. The well-tempered clavier is 24, and in the end, 48, eventually, preludes and fugues in all the keys that are possible, and they all sound amazingly in tune. And that was really an innovation. So this is an innovative piece, sort of. It's like all about technological advancement in instruments.
Why does this sound so familiar to me? It reminds me of things.
I think that's the power of so much of Bach's music as well, as a lot of the chord structures have been used since in so much of music. You might recognise Gounod's Ave Maria. That was written a century and a half after Bach's Prelude, but that was Ave Maria by Charles Gounod, written in 1853. And the Prelude is a heavy inspiration for Don't Cry for Me, Argentina by Andrew Lloyd Webber.
It won't be easy, you'll think it strange, when I try to explain how I feel, that I still need your love after all that I've done.
One of the things I wanted to really bring out with this piece is that we are very familiar with hearing it on piano, but of course it wasn't written for piano. It was actually written for the precursor of the piano, the clavier, which actually didn't have anywhere near as much sustain as the piano does. So if we actually go back to thinking about the link to this piece, is that when we hear it on the clavier, we can actually really hear that it is a piece about arpeggios, because the chords don't materialise because the sounds don't sustain themselves. But then when we hear it on a much more modern instrument, the piano, is that that's where we get the sense of these beautiful, luscious chords and this tension and release, which I think is one of the reasons why it feels a piece that has such relevance today. It feels very at home today, despite the fact that it was written many centuries ago.
Maybe we could hear a little bit of it on the harpsichord to hear the difference between that and the modern piano. So that was it on the harpsichord, Leo, but you mentioned the clavier. That is a kind of general term for the group of keyboard instruments it could have been. So harpsichord, other organs, a clavichord.
Indeed.
And it's the plucking, isn't it, rather than having that rhythm.
Exactly, yes. And that certainly with the instrument that we think that Bach was using at the time was starting to hit the strings rather than pluck as the harpsichord did. But the modern mechanisms that we have in the piano were far in the distant future. So that is why I think that Bach decided to write in the way that he did. Perhaps if he had a piano where we had this...
Track two, and what's the musical link?
Well, Lady Gaga. And this is because Bach is a composer that many people have gone back to, whether classical composers or songwriters, and that includes people in very much in the present day. And at the very beginning of the video of Bad Romance, we hear none other than the Bach B minor fugue.
Of Bad Romance by Lady Gaga from 2009. Now, Leo, back to your link, just briefly. We do hear some of that, what was in the video, in some of the work of Bach that we've already touched upon today, correct?
Exactly, yes. So it's from the same collection of pieces. And in this case, rather than being in C, it's all the way at the other end and it's in B. But what Lady Gaga has done is really transform it. And what we hear is actually the opening of the fugue much, much faster than the original. And to just demonstrate that, I will now play it on bassoon, and you can see the difference in terms of the speed.
So that was normal speed.
That was normal speed. So Lady Gaga is, well, easily double that.
What's really amazing about that fugue is that it's actually got all 12 notes of the scale in it. It's absolutely what we call the full chromatic, so all 12 notes of the scale, which contrasts enormously with her refrain that just comes in, which is just, you know, the open fifth. It's like she's doing the exact musical opposite right at the top of the song.
Well, let's break it down. Let's look at how it starts and how it develops. It's got this huge anacrusis where Gaga's isolated vocal just lands for four notes before you hear the drop. That's the best I can do. Sorry, everyone. And then you hear it with some drums quite low in the mix. So it's actually building quite slowly.
But it's funny, Jeffrey, because it actually starts with what is essentially a chorus.
Explain.
So by the time you've heard that riff that we just heard, you're singing it on the second time because all the notes are so close together and it's such a hook that you're in the middle of the action. You've heard the Bach, you've kind of got the idea that we're in for a kind of wild ride, and then immediately there's this anthemic thing that just wants you to sing along.
If we look really closely at this hook, there is actually an interesting relationship between the Bach at the beginning. Because if we think about the Bach, is that it's all about this semitone, the really small interval between notes, which resolve. So, for example, we hear all these small notes. And then if I slow down her lick, we have the exact same thing, that really small interval. So perhaps actually Bach really was the starting point of this piece.
We're talking about Bad Romance by American singer, songwriter and actress Lady Gaga, born Stephanie Joanne Angelina Germanotta in New York in 1986. The song taken from her 2009 EP, The Fame Monster, written by Gaga herself and collaborator Red One.
Jeffrey, Leo mentioned the video, but the video is quite iconic. I think you should tell us a little bit about the video
is astonishing. I mean, there's obviously the kind of ensemble dance troupe thing going on, which you see in a lot of pop videos, but you've got this kind of all-white costumes and these shapes being thrown by Lady Gaga, and they've become almost legendary for little monsters, as is the technical term for fans of Lady Gaga. Tells a story of being manipulated and empowered and disempowered, but meanwhile you are just on the dance floor because of that hook.
It's that thing about that musical sort of absolute simplicity about it, which I think makes it so catchy, and it's daring in its simplicity. And the way she delivers it with that full-throated vocal sound.
I think what's interesting is, in kind of comparison to the prelude that we listen to by Bach, where everything's harmony, you're hearing all of the harmonic rhythm, the movement, this is kind of one synth playing a note. There are so few chords in the tune. And then you just hear all of that expression that Gillian just mentioned in the vocals. You hear that over this kind of very, very bare synth, this kind of German house techno sort of synth. It sounds like an 80s track with the number of synths. And I think Lady Gaga was actually listening to a lot of this music when she was on tour in Eastern Europe. So she was being inspired by this kind of sound. And then when you put her voice with that simplicity, boom. How on your love? Every part of the song is so strong.
It's got hooks upon hooks, hasn't it?
Underlicks, riffs, hooks.
My goodness.
They're all in the song. Ra, ra, ah, 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 Roma, Roma, ma, ga, ga, ooh, la, la, wild, yobber, romance. She's sold 170 million records. She's the only female artist to achieve four singles, each selling at least 10 million copies globally.
Wow.
So thank you, Leo. Great choice. Bad Romance by Lady Gaga is track two in today's playlist. And I think that makes it your turn, Geoffrey. So where are you going to take us for track three and how did you get there?
I want to go back to that hook for a second, OK? The rah, rah, ooh, rah, rah. I was thinking about the rhythmic energy, how it drives forward with those very strong opening beats, followed by three quicker beats, like a 1-2, 1-2-3, 1-2, 1-2-3. That could have almost taken us to a cha-cha-cha, almost, but no. I decided to go east, to a song that features a similar shape melody to the Gaga hook, but all the way through, also creating a powerful driving forward motion, but with a totally different sonic palette. Folk song by the Ming Flute Ensemble from 1965. Almost sounded like a ringtone there for a second at the start. Reactions, are we feeling this? Gillian?
It's very arresting. You think initially there's not much to it, but in fact there is some interest in it because instruments layer up and build up and it's got quite a beguiling sound, particularly that wooden flute, or is it a bamboo flute, which is doing that fantastically ornamented, very simple line, but it's the interest in it is the way it's quite vocal because it makes you think of somebody singing because they're actually freely adding ornaments to the very, very simple melody, which is basically two or three notes.
Just like the Lady Gaga that you're mentioning.
Just like the Lady Gaga, yeah.
Leo?
Well, actually, I think your connection is a fantastic one.
Thank you, Leo.
Because there are the exact same notes, in fact. So I'm going to boot Gillian off the piano and I'll show you.
OK, right. Gillian has been politely booted off the piano. Leo is at the keys.
So you were mentioning, of course, the lick. And actually, we hear in the tune, so we have the same perfect fifth, is the interval that we call it, which is then present in both tunes, and both very significantly as well.
It made me think of my friend Dan Shao. He's a flautist and he has a group called the Tangram Ensemble that explore music from Asia. And I said, Dan, we've got this tune, we'd like to know some more about it. Please, can you help us out?
So this song, a Tile folk song, is a folk song from the indigenous people of Taiwan, the Tile people. And I absolutely love this song, which makes use of many typical Diza ornaments. Quick upper grace notes to embellish any melody. That's a big thing in Chinese music, adding lots of extra notes to things to just make it even more beautiful and add your own creativity as well. Slides, as the wooden bamboo Chinese flute is open hold compared to the Western flute that has keys covering the holes. You can slide your fingers gradually on and off, which adds a slide to the sound, of course, and this just has so much potential for extra expression. I absolutely love it. This piece has a simple harmonic landscape in a minor kind of idiom, leaning into parallel fifths and drones. Of course, that's a big thing in Chinese music. Without any kind of major big key changes, there's a big focus on revolving around the tonic, the home key. And there's loads of different moods in this song created by section changes shown by different percussion.
The voice of flautist Daniel Schau there, giving us a bit more insight. I like this idea of ornamentation and grace notes. What do we mean when we say grace notes and ornamentation? You're holding something different, Leo.
Well, I've changed my bassoon to something far smaller, which is in fact a flute.
Uh-huh.
But importantly, I don't have a bamboo flute, and there's a very big difference. So firstly, of course, a bamboo flute is made of bamboo, and it's a very simple instrument. It simply is a hollowed-out bamboo with holes in it, whereas what I'm holding is the Western flute, which is made of metal and has a matrix of keys. And unsurprisingly is that these two instruments are designed to do very different sorts of things, which means that, for example, sliding and grace notes, very fast notes, become quite easy on a bamboo flute. On a more modern flute, some of them become more difficult, particularly in relation to the specific key that we are in. But I can try my best.
OK, first of all, could you explain grace note?
Absolutely. So a grace note is essentially a very fast note, and it can either be on the beat or before the beat. So something like... So it's a very fast little inflection and something that is usually used expressively, in fact, both in Western traditions and indeed throughout the world.
We talked about slides.
So this is where my flute simply can't do it.
OK, good.
But my saxophone can.
But Jess Gillam's saxophone can. All right.
Because on the saxophone you can open the key ever so slowly and the note still speaks, and do it with your embouchure at the same time. Mm. You can do it a little bit more right across the instrument as well. And that's quite haunting and quite intense.
Yeah.
But you can hear it's all of the in-between. It's like the way that you would, as a snake would, slither between places. It kind of gives this sort of feeling of ambiguity. You're in between pitches. You're never quite sure where you are. It's such a cool effect.
A Tile folk song by Ming Flute Ensemble. Tile actually translates roughly to human or man, the word tile. So we're talking about music of humans.
Thank you, Geoffrey. This is Add to Playlist on BBC Radio 4 with me, Jess Gillam, in place of Kerris Matthews today, who will hopefully be back in this chair next time.
And me, Geoffrey Boachi. Our guests today are Leo Geyer and Gillian Moore. Quick recap, please, Jess, on the track so far.
Well, we started with the prelude in C major from the Well Tempered Clavier by Bach. And then we moved to track two, which was Bad Romance by Lady Gaga. Track three that we just heard was a Tile folk song by the Ming Flute Ensemble. And Gillian, now it's your turn. And you know the score. Where do those bamboo flutes lead you and why?
Well, I didn't know until right this moment when you said it, Geoffrey, that the tile actually means human and is related to the human body, because that's where it took me, in fact, in a very different direction. So I was thinking about that insistent rhythm that's on the, we think it's a xylophone, right in the middle that goes all the way through like this, I think. And that is this rhythm. Short, long, short, long, short, long, which is the iambic rhythm. And iambic means heartbeat. And of course, so much music is based on the human body, on the pulse, on the heartbeat. But I wanted to go quite specifically into music that really has been associated with the physical nature of the heartbeat. We've, of course, got Buddy Holly, Heartbeat, with that insistent rhythm. It's not quite exactly that rhythm, but it's definitely the regular rhythm and definitely linked to that. There's a great track by Childish Gambino, which has got that, you know, in the bass line. But then I went to a kind of mega symphony.
the opening of the first of four movements of Gustav Mahler's Symphony No. 9 in D major, written between 1908 and 1909.
Mahler died in 1911 at the age of just 50. He was diagnosed with a heart condition, and shortly after he had this diagnosis, he started writing his ninth symphony. He was very superstitious about the number nine because he was thinking about composers like Beethoven and Bruckner who'd written nine symphonies and then died. So he did everything he could to put off writing a ninth symphony, but eventually he did. And although he himself never said it, people, including the great Leonard Bernstein, has suggested that the opening of the piece, which in fact gives us a rhythm which appears all the way through the giant first movement of this work, is in fact some kind of transcription of his arrhythmic heartbeat, which had just been diagnosed. So it's not your classic short, long, regularly, at least not yet, not at the very opening. It's something a little bit more off kilter. A lot of people have said that this piece is all about death. You know, they're kind of almost retrofitting Mahler's life story because he did die 2 years after it was completed and he never heard it performed. And the really important thing for me about this piece is that while, yes, that opening might suggest something very fragile, very vulnerable, it celebrates everything that's wonderful about life. I mean, this half-an-hour movement is only the first of four, and we've got everything. We've got dances, we've got waltzes, we've got country music, and then at the very end, it's only, again, at the very end that we come right back to the idea of death and the kind of quite devastating slow final movement.
And those musical ideas, they grow to be so massive. The way that he kind of switches between this, however we think of it, this kind of vulnerable, fragmented, dreamy opening, to these really quite almost raging sections, and yeah, the way he switches so quickly.
The tune, that beautiful tune that we just heard the beginnings of, that comes in a very passionate version. And in fact, one of the notes early in the tune, it's almost like the tune can't contain itself and it screams right at the top of the orchestra, just that one note. And of course, Leonard Bernstein makes the very most of that.
What it is, so fragmented, so tiny at the beginning, to these huge things, back and forth and back. It's always changing.
Mahler really is conductor's music, and that reflects the fact that actually Mahler himself was an astonishing conductor. And you can see that in his writing, particularly with all of these incredible terms that his scores are littered with. That's what makes this music so exciting to conduct, because we're also talking about such huge length, you know, 90 minutes. You have to be so careful and conscious about where these really important moments are. It's why we conductors spend a lot of time sitting on our own in silence, looking at the score, to really study it and really get a sense of what is the musical journey? Where are these important moments that we need to bring out and to be hushed and to find it?
Jess, tell us a bit more about Mahler himself. Who was he?
So he was an Austro-Bohemian, maybe romantic composer, but he was most famously, as Leo said, in his lifetime, a conductor. But in the summers, often when he wasn't conducting or music directing, he would go to a cabin in the woods and compose. And he's thought of as a or the master symphonist. And his most famous quote is, "A symphony must be like the world. It must contain everything." Tragically, he had a lot of pain in his life. He experienced the death of seven of his siblings in his childhood, and then his own beloved four-year-old daughter, Maria, died of scarlet fever a few years before he wrote this piece. And on the day she passed away, his mother-in-law came and she kind of didn't feel well and she had a heart attack. So they brought the doctor to speak to her mum and check her heart. And Mahler said he always prided himself on being in great health. He said, "Oh, I'll get my heart checked at the same time." And on that day, he was diagnosed with the heart condition that then the Ninth Symphony is kind of reflecting in the heartbeat.
Thank you, Gillian. Track four today is the first movement from Symphony No. 9 in D major by Gustav Mahler. It's time for your second bite of the cherry, Jess. Where are you going to take us to round off this episode, and how did you get there?
So I was thinking about this idea of the Ninth Symphony being Mahler's last completed symphony. And we have that motif that can be taken as the irregular heartbeat pattern at the opening. And I was thinking about tunes that have a similar sort of musical metaphor. I thought about the end of Tchaikovsky's Pathetique Symphony, where the heartbeat slowly dies away. You just hear it with the double basses fading at the end. I thought about the brilliant Esperanza Spalding tune, Lest We Forget Blood, that pays homage to the human body. But I decided we should leave the heartbeat behind and move on to the idea of final works, swan songs. So I settled on a track by the Starman himself, David Bowie.
Yes.
It's Lazarus from his final album, Black Star. It was released in December 2015, just a month before he died. And Tony Visconti, Bowie's legendary producer, said the lyrics and video of Lazarus were intended to be a self-epitaph, a commentary on Bowie's own impending death.
Look up here, I'm in heaven. I've got scars that can't be seen. I've got drama, can't be stolen. Everybody knows me now.
It's an absolutely amazing song, and right from the opening, you're kind of in this sort of ethereal sort of feeling. So the very opening notes that you hear, the repeated notes, you'd think they're a guitar, but it's actually a bass played. It's about as high as a bass guitar can go, and then it's drenched in a bit of reverb. So you're hearing something that's already about to snap.
Wow.
You're kind of at the tension from the beginning, and he sets you up with this almost angular sort of drum beat with then this bass just playing these repeated notes that go, and then the first line, look up here, I'm in heaven.
Leo, you picked up your bassoon.
I have, which maybe feels a little inappropriate given that there isn't a bassoon in this tune. But one of the things that I think is really interesting here, which is what Jess has mentioned, is the use of reverb. So this is a technique that is used in studio recordings to make a sound feel like it's in a bigger space. So without it, it feels like the instrument is right next to your face. And with reverb, it could feel like you're in a cathedral. And that is used really heavily in this tune to get a real sense of kind of distance and ethereal feelings. And I wondered if we could show how this works. So I'm going to play a little bit of the sax line, and we can do it without any reverb, and then we can try it with reverb. So this is without. And now with reverb. And essentially what the reverb does is that it blurs the line so that we don't get the immediate clarity of those pitches, but they blur together to create a sense of harmony, essentially, and a very kind of heart-wrenching harmony at that.
That reverb and that kind of wide open space. It's really cool that he's layering up the saxophones as well within that reverb. And if you listen really closely, you can hear in the background, I think it's a Wurlitzer organ that's playing these kind of sort of little moving passages, but rather than using the keyboard instrument to outline the harmony and play the chords, it's built up saxophones with reverb. So you're hearing the Bowie, as he always was, subverting expectation, using instruments in a way that you wouldn't necessarily expect to hear them, and it creates a different colour. And he does the same with his vocal line, his first line, look up here, I'm in heaven, but it's a descending line. Look up here, I'm in heaven, and he's going down. So it's how he was, always connecting, always being slightly opposite, always being a little bit subversive.
Look up here, I'm in heaven.
I want to talk about the notes in that little sax phrase. It's very simple, but it's incredibly powerful and potent.
It's the falling thing. It goes down a fourth, like, that's the fourth, and then you've got a single step in between. So it's that falling, and I think this falling motif is something that is so powerful. But the fact that it is this, you know, what they call a dying fall in Shakespeare, you know, that phrase which goes downwards. In fact, going back to Mahler, the last movement of that symphony, which is so explicitly about death, starts with three notes following, and people say that's based on Abide With Me, the hymn, which is again associated with death and funerals, that three notes going down. And I think that's a motif that really gives this piece the flavour of death, in fact.
And it's all the more devastating because we weren't expecting this release. We didn't know Boy was ill. And the musicians that recorded this with him, who we should definitely name because they are amazing, it's Tim LaFave on bass, Matt Giuliani on drums, the one and only Donny McCaslin on saxophone, and Ben Monder on guitar, that is absolutely drenched in distortion, and it sounds amazing. They'd all signed NDAs. They weren't saying that they were recording with him. They just told their close family. And he recorded this album having been diagnosed with cancer but didn't know that it was terminal, and then released this single, and the cancer had spread, and then he passed away in the January. This was released in the December of 2015, and he passed away in January 2016. So then to have that kind of slightly eerie, is there something in the deep subconscious of knowing, and it makes it all the more haunting for this release to have come. He died 2 days later after Black Star, the album, had been released.
But he's been surprising us and astonishing us since, you know, the early 1970s, and this was the last move, and how extraordinary it was.
We're talking about Lazarus by David Bowie, born David Robert Jones in Brixton, South London, on the 8th of January 1947, died the 10th of January 2016.
The thing that really grabs you at this moment is the expression in his voice, so that he's purposely not singing in a straight tone and singing exactly the pitches, but he's always kind of swooping up. There's a little bit of growl in the voice, and we just feel this emotion coming from him.
There's a patience, and there's a very, very steady pace throughout the whole thing, but it builds with so much power.
And he leaves the whole of the last 2 minutes to the saxophone, where he started. He doesn't even sing, and he started as a saxophone player, and that's where he leaves the end of the song.
Thank you for our final track today, Jess, Lazarus by David Bowie. And that's about it for today. Huge thanks to our studio guests on the bassoon and flute, Leo Gaia. Oh, that was a nice low note there. We like that one.
And at the grand piano today, Gillian Moore.
Huge thanks goes to you, Jess, for stepping in today.
It's been great fun.
If all goes well, Keris will return with her well-rested arm for our next episode. We're wishing you well, Keris. Don't forget that all episodes are available to download or stream on BBC Sounds. Now, Gillian, Leo, maybe even Jess as well. As is tradition, we like to play out an episode with a little musical number.
Well, what we can do is, with a little bit of reorchestration, and I'm sure Mahler won't mind, is that we can do a little bit of the beginning of Mahler's Ninth Symphony. Some kind of fade. And